Take your Bibles with me, if you will, please, and turn to Exodus chapter 34. Exodus chapter 34. We're going to pick up the reading with verse 29 in just a moment, but let me set the stage for you about what we're about to read in this passage. Exodus 34. Moses, the lawgiver, has just received the second edition of the Ten Commandments. You may remember from Exodus 32 that the first edition was destroyed, because when Moses came down from the mountain and he saw the people dancing around the golden calf, he had a little meltdown moment. And he threw the stone tablets on the ground and they were shattered. And so God tells Moses, go back up to the mountain, and I'm going to give you Ten Commandments 2.0. And the presence of God comes down in the form of a cloud and speaks to Moses. And Moses is up on that mountain for 40 days and 40 nights listening to God. And then he chisels out another set of tablets and he writes the words of the Ten Commandments on those. And Moses is now ready to come down from the mountain and present the covenant to the people. And that's where we pick up our reading in Exodus 34 and verse 29. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the covenant law in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them, so Aaron and all the leaders of the community came back to him, and he spoke to them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near him, and he gave them all the commands the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, they saw his face was radiant. Then Moses would put the veil back over his face until he went in to speak with the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God, and we all say together, thanks be to God. Well, when Moses came down from Mount Sinai, his face was radiant. It was beaming with light. He had been in the divine presence for so long that the Shekinah glory of God had actually transferred over to him. And there was a noticeable and obvious difference. He was literally glowing with the radiance and holiness of God. Even in our day, when people get really excited, their faces beam or they shine. When people look at a bride in all of her splendor, we say, oh, she looks radiant. They never say that about the groom. Nobody cares what the groom looks like. They care about what the bride looks like. Sometimes when we see a woman who is great with child, we say, oh, look, she looks radiant. And Moses wasn't a bride and he wasn't pregnant, but his face was radiant. And the reason was obvious. He had been lingering in the presence of God. 1 John chapter 1 verse 5 says, God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. And that's why people who walk with God cannot walk in the darkness anymore. Because God's light dispels the dark. God's light drives away the darkness. And when God's light gets transferred to us, we become bearers of that light. And that's how Moses' face was. His face was so radiant that people were even a little afraid to come over to him. He looked like kind of radioactive. He was blinding. They were afraid Moses could go off at any minute. And so they kept their distance. They stayed away. But they were also impressed. And I'm sure that they would be talking in the camp like this: wow, that Moses, he's a really spiritual guy. Because nobody else in the camp shines like he does. You can tell Moses has been with God. And Moses, he kind of liked the fact that people thought that way about him. He liked it that people could recognize he had been in God's presence. He liked the impression it gave. And so he did something very interesting. He put a veil over his face. Now, at first you may think that Moses did that to be considerate. Maybe you thought that, oh, well, he didn't want to hurt anybody's eyes with his brilliance. Maybe you thought he didn't want the community to be put off by his shiny face. He didn't want to have to buy sunglasses for everybody in the camp. And you might think he put on the veil so that no one would feel uncomfortable. But we quickly discover that that's not the reason at all. Because we're told that whenever Moses would enter the Lord's presence in the tent of meeting, he would take the veil off again and his face would get recharged. And then he would come out again, not wearing the veil. And then he would tell the people what God had told him to say, and they would notice that his face was glowing again, and they would say, hey, look, Moses must have been in God's presence again. Look at his face. He looks like he's been tanning. But did you notice that after he had spoken to the people, and after they could see that his face was radiant again, that Moses would put the veil back on? Not before he talked to the people, but after he talked to the people. Apparently, Moses wanted the people to see his face glowing, or he would have put the veil on before he spoke. Now, why would he do that? Because he wanted them to know he'd been in God's presence. And so he kept the veil off until after they had seen him. And Moses, we're told, would repeat this pattern over and over again. In God's presence, the veil would come off, and then he would show himself to the people with the veil still off and his face glowing, and then the veil would go back on so Moses could go about his regular business. Now stay with me. Some of you are thinking, well, I never heard this story about Moses. I'm not really sure how it all got started. Maybe Moses woke up one morning and he looked in the mirror and he said, wait a minute, my face isn't shining anymore. My face is starting to fade a little bit. And he knew that if people saw him with a faded face, they wouldn't be as impressed, and they might even go so far as to say, maybe Moses isn't as close to God as we thought he was. Now, before you think that's kind of a problem to say it that way, it's interesting to me that the Apostle Paul picked up on this story in a very fascinating section of the second letter to the Corinthian church. And we happen to have that letter in our Bibles. I want you to look at what Paul says about this particular instance in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13. Moses put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. So that's a little different version. That says passing away. Moses, let me read it to you again in this version. Moses put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. What's Paul saying here? He's basically saying that Moses wanted to give the impression that he was more radiant than he really was. And so he walked around with a veil to keep it covered up. That's what Paul's saying. It's a little bit like makeup. Now, I'm certainly not a cosmetic expert. I gladly concede to all of our Mary Kay consultants in the room today, but makeup does apply to what we're talking about here. I like what John Ortberg says, that one of the defining moments in any dating relationship is the first time you see the other person without her makeup on. It's a defining moment because makeup, he says, is kind of like facial deception. Because if you think about it, makeup is designed to change your normal way of looking. It makes your eyes look bigger. It makes your lips look fuller. It makes your skin more vibrant. It makes your nose look nosier. And it's intended to kind of hide flaws that may be there without the makeup on. That's why we call it makeup. You know, the first time I saw my oldest daughter all dolled up with makeup, it's like it stopped me in my tracks. And she was like 11 or 12 years old. I said, "You go back to your room and play with your Barbies immediately." I didn't want her looking like the way she looked when she put that makeup on. It does change a little bit the way somebody looks. By the way, guys, you know you're really in love with her when you see her for the first time. She's got the old sweatpants on, the baggy sweatshirt, her hair's up in a ponytail, and she has no makeup, and you still think to yourself, "Wow, I like this look. I could wake up to that every single morning." That's when you know that you're really hooked. But listen to it again. Makeup. I've been told, somebody heard me preach a sermon once, and they said, "You know, Pastor, there's also such a thing as cover up." I don't even know what that means, but apparently there is. And Paul says that that's what Moses was doing with this veil. He was using it as kind of like makeup, as cover up, because he knew that as wonderful as it was, the glory of God in the old covenant was a fading glory. Because the moment that you leave God's presence in the old covenant, the radiance starts to fade. And I think that's a perfect description of people, some people in the church today. Because there are people who have known God's glory in the past, but it was a long time ago, maybe even 75 years ago, and the glory has faded. And other things, maybe even legitimate things, have captured their attention, become priorities, and because they aren't lingering in God's presence, their faces just don't glow anymore. They don't have glowing faces. They're Christians, but they just don't radiate the Shekinah. They have a fading glory. And so here's what we do as religious people sometimes when we feel like the radiance is fading. We wear masks so people won't know the glory is gone. And sometimes we put on spiritual makeup to enhance the way we look or to cover up what our heart might feel like. And it's hard to be real when that's the way you're doing it, because if you're really authentic and real about what was going on, then people might see how empty you feel. And they have all the cosmetics of religion. They just don't have a vital relationship with Jesus. And when you don't have an ongoing, vital, dynamic relationship with Jesus, I want to tell you something. There's no radiance. There's no shine. There's no glow. There's no authenticity. And so if you're religious, you put on makeup. I think most of you know by now that I grew up in a town called Bethany, right there in Oklahoma. That's my hometown. I love Bethany. Bethany is kind of an unusual place. It was actually started by a group of Nazarenes with three different entities. It had a church, it had a school, it had an orphanage. Today they are called Bethany First Church of the Nazarene, Southern Nazarene University, and the Children's Center of Oklahoma. Bethany, you may not know, though, was created to be kind of like an enclave or like a spiritual commune, away from worldliness and away from godlessness. It was like kind of a Nazarene ghetto. And for many, many years, even in my youngest years, I can remember there was never businesses open on Sunday. You could not serve alcohol anywhere in that city any day of the week. You couldn't purchase it, and it wasn't served within city limits of Bethany. There's actually, you're going to think I'm kidding you, but there was actually a blue line that surrounded the perimeter of Bethany on the concrete. You can still see remnants of it today, so you would know when you were coming into Bethany and when you were leaving Bethany. Like, enter into the Holy of Holies and, you know, go out into a terrible world. That's what Bethany was like. That's why we started calling it the Bethany Bubble. I remember when I was in grade school, you know, all of my teachers were Nazarene teachers. I went to a public school, by the way. It wasn't a private school. It just happened to be everybody I knew were Nazarenes. In fact, when I met my wife, Christy, at a baseball game when we were 16, I asked her where she went to church. That was actually my pickup line. I had two pickup lines. Where do you go to church? The other one was, hey, nice Bible. No, that wasn't one. So when Christy told me I don't go to church, I'd never met a girl. I honestly don't know that I'd met a girl that didn't go to church. And so I loved her immediately. No. I remember when I was in grade school, the first time that we heard a curse word on the playground said out loud. We were shocked. I mean, we were completely indignant. And we took our third grade selves and we went over to our teacher and said, they said a cuss word. And that fifth grader got cast outside the camp immediately. We even, growing up, we had sanctified fighting. We fought with each other like sanctified grade schoolers. You would never get away with this today, but our principal, his name was Mr. Brown. I became his pastor when I was an adult. Mr. Brown brought out these giant boxing gloves. When he felt like two guys were starting to get too heated, he said, we're going to do this the right way. He put these giant red boxing gloves on us, and my skinny arms, I had a couple of fights. My arms are so skinny, and those gloves were so big, it looked like these giant Q-tips. And we would just punch on each other till we were exhausted, which is usually like about 15 or 20 seconds. And we couldn't hurt each other with those gloves. And he'd say, are you done now? And we'd say, yes. We fought sanctified. Now, not all of those things were bad. In fact, it's good to create safe environments where our kids can be protected from temptations and dangers of society. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. It's good to have a culture with Christian values. But sometimes, when you live in cultures like that, it can also make people superficial. And it can make them inauthentic. And it can make some people act like they're Christian on the outside, when their heart isn't really pure and clean on the inside. That's what the Bible talks about when it says that people can have a form of godliness without the power. And if we're not careful, folks like us can begin to look more like Pharisees than we do like Jesus. And so sometimes we put the veil on to deceive, but not so much to deceive. Sometimes we just put it on just to get by. It's not because we're trying to fake it, it's because we're trying to make it without the glory. Did you know it's possible to try and make it in your Christian walk without the glory? You say, David, what kind of glory are you talking about? Well, for Moses, the glory was the law. The glory was those Ten Commandments. It was good. The Ten Commandments weren't laborious. I mean, they weren't heavy burdens to bear. It was glorious because for the first time in human history, it showed people this is the way God is calling you to live. This is the right way to live. It wasn't just a burden to them. It was like, finally, we know there is a way to be righteous. And so it came to them, and the Bible writers talk about it. It's like honey to our lips. It was a glorious thing, but there was one problem with the law. It did not offer you the power to live it. It told you how to live, but it gave you no power to live it. And so it was a glory, but it was a fading glory. But all of that changed with Jesus. Because Jesus came to give life and spirit. He came to not only show us the right way to live, but to offer us a righteousness to actually live the way he called us to live. And Paul describes that reality here in a beautiful way. And we didn't put it up on the screens, but it's so powerful. I want to go back to this Corinthians passage and let you hear directly from the Apostle Paul what the new glory can look like. Are you ready? He says this, whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. And we, who with unveiled faces, we now reflect, all of us, he says, the Lord's glory. And we are being transformed into his likeness with an ever-increasing, say ever-increasing, ever-increasing glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Man, I wish I could imprint this on you. This is such an important thing to understand. In Exodus 33, for example, just one chapter before, there's this fascinating conversation that goes on between God and Moses. And at the end of that conversation, Moses dared to say this. He actually dared to say it. Now show me your glory. And God said, all right, Moses, I'm going to cause all of my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, but you cannot see my face, for no one can see my face and live. And so here's what I'm going to do, Moses. There's going to be a place near me where you can stand on a rock, and when my glory passes by, I'm going to put you into a little crevice, a little crack in that rock, and I'm going to place my hand over you until I pass by, and then I'm going to remove my hand, and you're going to be able to look out, and you're going to be able to see my back, but my face you cannot see. You remember that? Now, why could you not see God's face? Because no one can stand in the light of the blazing majesty and greatness of God and survive. It will kill you. His glory is so glorious. His holiness is so holy, it will kill us. It will overcome us. And so out of love for Moses and for Moses' protection, God says, I'm going to hide you in this rock. I'm going to put a little bit of body armor around you. I'm going to cover you up until my glory passes by. You're going to see my backside. You're going to get a glimpse, but the glimpse of my glory, even from the backside, is going to be so glorious that your face is going to be shining and radiating afterwards. And basking in God's presence, even in that partial way, was enough to just set Moses on fire. But now, Paul comes along and he says something to us that is absolutely cosmic. He says, that is the old covenant. And as glorious as it is and was, the new covenant that God brings will completely blow the doors off. Because he said, in Jesus, are you ready for this? He says, in Jesus, we no longer see the backside of God. Now we see God face to face. Face to face. You know, this word reflect, it's the word kataprizo in the original language. And kataprizo, when you look at it, it means to carefully behold. It means to look. It means to contemplate. It means to study something. It means to ponder. It means to stare at something and just gaze at it and reflect on what it means. And Paul says, with unveiled faces, we now kataprizo, the Lord's glory. We see him now, face to face. There's no more backside. There's no more covering us with his hand. There's no more veils. There's no more makeup. There's no more cover-up. There's nothing between us now, because when we gaze into the face of Jesus, we are looking into the face of God. In fact, John's gospel says it this way: the Word, the eternal Logos of God, the Word became flesh and dwelled among us, tabernacled among us. And then look at what he says: we have seen his what? Glory. We've seen his doxa. We've seen the glory of the one and the only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. We beheld his glory face to face. And so now in the new covenant, with unveiled faces, we gaze into the face of God. And as we do, you want to talk about what holiness is? You want to talk about how holiness happens? It's when we are continually gazing into the face of Jesus until we become transformed into his likeness and his image. And it's an ever-increasing glory. In fact, one translation says, from glory to glory to glory to glory. And as we reflect on Jesus, his Spirit begins to purify our hearts, and he transforms us, not just to be saved from something, but to be saved for something. And now we become a part of reflecting his image in the world. Did you know when you gaze on Jesus, your life gets changed? One of the great privileges I've had in the last 10 years of being a general superintendent is to interview missionary candidates. It happens in the month of February, and all of the candidates, they come in and they meet with the Board of General Superintendents, and I've met some of the most extraordinary people in those interviews. I have never left one of those missionary interviews without just feeling completely recharged and in wanting to charge the gates of hell again. How many of you know the church is on offense? And when you hear from those missionaries, believe me, you're not playing defense anymore. You're playing offense. But there was one missionary couple that walked in a few years ago that I'd never seen happen quite what happened when they did. Their names are John and Niamal Ual. Ual, we also say that in Oklahoma, but that's not how you spell their name. That's y'all. John and Naomi Ual, they serve refugees on your behalf, the Church of the Nazarene, in East Africa, specifically Sudan. They are the very first missionaries to be commissioned as refugees to refugees. And when they walked in the room, I had never seen anybody's face shining like John Ewall's face was shining. And I don't mean it was the beautiful color of his dark skin. He had beautiful dark skin. But I mean his face was glowing with the radiance of the Shekinah glory of God. It was literally beaming with light. I couldn't take my eyes off of him. I couldn't stop looking at his face. I thought, how does somebody radiate the glory of God like that? It was his eyes. It was his smile. It was like he had been basking in the presence of Jesus for so long that now Jesus was radiating off of him. And that's when it hit me. When you're in a 99% Islamic country and Christianity is persecuted and people are actually taught to resist the Christian faith, you're probably not going to win people to Christ through apologetics. You're probably not going to win people to Christ because you say, look what the Bible says. You want to know how you're going to win people to Christ when 99% of them are resisting you? There's only one way. You got to have a shiny face. You got to be able to walk into a room and have somebody say, wow, something happened to that person. You want to know how you win refugees to Jesus? You let the light of Jesus reflect off of your face. And you know what? I think we're living in a culture right now where we're all going to have to be missionaries. And I think the one thing that's going to work better than any argument we could project, than anybody say, let's get back to the Bible, or any picketing, whatever else you think may be the right answer. I'll tell you, the one thing that's going to win Southwest Indiana is not an argument. It's a shiny face. It's when a group of people called Nazarenes who believe in the holiness of God have the holiness of God reflecting off of their faces in such a way that people are compelled to say, what makes you different? Authenticity in the Christian life does not mean you're working hard and trying to be sincere. Real authenticity comes because the very life of Jesus is reflecting God's glory onto you, and now you're reflecting it back to the world. And when you can have that kind of real, authentic, Holy Spirit holiness in your life, that's when you're set free. You don't have to do any more hiding. You don't have to do any more cover-up. You don't have to do any more pretending. You just say, this is who I am in Christ. There's no veil. And I'm being transformed from glory to glory to glory. That's the holiness that doesn't fade. I have a friend who is a 20-year crack-free, spirit-filled believer. And every day, he said to me, when I was his pastor, he said, Pastor, you know what I do every day? I wake up and I look in the mirror at my face and I say, Holy Spirit, I know you're in there somewhere. Please reveal yourself. I said, Butch, that's a great way to think about life. Moses saw a partial glory, and his face would always fade. But you and I, we see him face to face. And face-to-face glory is the only thing that's going to change you and transform you and make you a real Pentecost witness to the world. And all God's people said together, amen.